Hi, everybody. This is going to be a very interesting combination. You guys are experiencing lunch coma, and I'm on a sugar high. So we'll see how this works out. So I'll be talking about some interesting techniques that we've come across for interrupt coalescing for virtual machines. So the outline of the talk is pretty simple. We're going to be talking about interrupts and interrupts and interrupts and lots more interrupts. This idea of interrupts has been in active use since the early days of computers. So a really quick introduction here. Time is on the x-axis here, going towards the right, increasing. I'm also going to add another independent device. So the I/O device is usually a separate embedded computer. Let's say that the execution is in user mode right now, and there's a user process continuing to execute. Well, at some point in time, an I/O device may receive a completion, as a result of which it'll fire an interrupt. The execution will move to the interrupt handler, from where it'll probably go back to the kernel. The kernel will do some work. You end up back at user level. Now, suppose that this user program wants to actually do an I/O, come back into the kernel, eventually to the driver, and as a result of probably some PCI register writes, the I/O will be requested. Now what happens is the user application, the execution returns to the user mode, and there's parallel execution of the I/O request and the user application. At some point in time, the I/O is completed, and the whole cycle repeats itself. Really simple. Now, speaking of interrupts, Dijkstra had the following to say. I'll let you actually read this yourself. For what it's worth, the capitalization is Dijkstra's, not mine, from his manuscript number 1303. Interestingly, Dijkstra's work on interrupts is circa 1957, and the machine that he worked on was the Electrologica X1. Maybe we can do a quick poll, wake people up again. Raise your hands if this is the first time you're hearing of the Electrologica X1. Okay, either there's a few people sleeping or they didn't understand the question. Let's try this again. Okay. Let's see if this picture can jog your memory. Is there anybody here who has heard of or seen or played or programmed on the X1 that is in the audience? Okay. Well, it turns out that the X1 is a very interesting machine from a historical perspective. Anyway, let's get back to interrupts. So I said that Dijkstra worked on interrupts on the X1. Here's what he had to say about it. And I'll just read this out loud. Halfway through the functional design of the X1, I guess early 1957, Bram Loopstra and Carol Scholten confronted me with the idea of the interrupt. And I remember that I panicked. Being used to machines with reproducible behavior, how was I going to identify a bug if I had introduced one? He goes on to say, after I had delayed the decision to include the interrupt for 3 months, Bram and Carol flattered me out of my resistance. And it was decided that an interrupt would be included, and I began to study the problem. Now, he went on to design the interrupt handler scheme for the X1. According to his manuscripts, it comprised about 900 instructions, and this became part of the work that was included in his PhD. Okay, so here's a revelation. Turns out that computers didn't always have interrupts then. Actually, Knuth credits Dijkstra with the independent invention of an interrupt system. But historically, Edsger Dijkstra was actually not the first one. So let's look at timeline here. 1954, the NBS DICIAC machine was the first one to have an I/O interrupt. Now, traps existed before this. For example, we had the UNIVAC 1 with an overflow trap. But the first one is 1954 for I/O. Then you fast forward a little bit, you get to 1955, UNIVAC 1103A has wind tunnel interrupts. It's really interesting, they actually connected them for real-time data collection with wind tunnels. Now, to be able to get into the time that Dijkstra's operating, now we're looking at 1957 to 59. 59 is when Dijkstra's dissertation was published. In this time, independently in the US and in Amsterdam, people working on interrupts, so the IBM Stretch machine, which I think there's one in the Computer History Museum, Lincoln Labs TX2, which has this really interesting instruction set architecture support built in for nested interrupts and critical sections. And of course, the X1 that I already mentioned, which had a really nice vector interrupt system, which is the same design pattern that we find today. So by the time that you get to 1960, pretty much every computer being built has interrupt support. And those that don't are deliberate design choices, for example, for experimental designs to try alternates to interrupts, or for the simplicity of polling like a couple of the Cray machines. In the 1960s, deferred interrupt handling starts to get used. And you know, you find this in the Linux kernel today. And I'm not quite sure why this particular optimization has been dropped and picked back up throughout history. By 1966, you have the Burroughs B5500, which adds an instruction to test for additional interrupts before returning from the handler. Okay, by the early 1970s, three interrupt overhead optimization design patterns have already emerged. And these will remain essentially unchanged for the next 30 years. So let's go over them. Number one, when there's an interrupt, you try to complete more than one I/O. Okay? And this is what the B5500 had introduced with their test instruction. Number two, you spin wait a little bit before dismissing in the handler. Now, this is not a very common technique, but it was definitely mentioned in literature. And the third, most common one, is after dismissing the interrupt, get the hardware I/O controller to delay the next interrupt. Now, the first two are operating systems techniques. The third one is hardware controller and, of course, the coordination of the operating system. So during the 1980s, we see high-speed devices really take off, of course, with Ethernet and SCSI and so forth. And the resulting research yields very interesting designs and dozens of patents in this area. To this day, network interrupt handling schemes are obeying essentially the same framework of the 70s and trading off the kind of the same set of parameters. So these are the two. MIDL, middle, which a term that I coined, maximum interrupt delay latency. This is basically like a deadline. After a completion enters the I/O controller, how long will it, what's the maximum amount of time that it'll delay before issuing the interrupt up to the host? The second one is the maximum coalesce count. And this is for an early delivery of the interrupt before that deadline expires. So if your MCC is 5 and you reach 5 I/O completions, you issue the interrupt earlier than that deadline. Okay. So throughout the 80s, 90s, and 2000s, dozens of patents in this area of actually coming up with interesting ways of modifying these parameters for optimizations. Now, this was also true for storage devices until 1998, when the earlier example of fundamentally changing the rules that I could find. Okay, and this comes in with an LSI logic patent filed in 1998, where they changed the rules. They said, okay, instead of looking at MCC and MIDL, let's actually look at commands in flight and use that to set the delay timer. Because for I/O, for storage I/O, you actually know whenever there's an outstanding command. But this is the first time, and it took 30 years for this optimization to come in. Now, you fast forward to 2008, and we have the work that I'll be describing, which builds on all this previous 60 years of research. Now, compared to the LSI patent, we also had the same intuition that we're using. And by the way, our work was done completely independent. We were not aware of their work. We became aware of it when we were doing related work research for our paper. They have the same intuition, but we use it very differently. We use the commands in flight to set fine-grained delivery ratios, whereas they're working with delay timers. As a result, our design does not need high-resolution timers, and we also have several other things that are unique in our design, including interprocessor interrupts and coalescing of those, which I won't get into today, but I really encourage you to look at. So I counted 4 Turing Award recipients who appear to have, at some point in time or another, contributed to interrupt processing, including Edsger Dijkstra, John McCarthy, Fernando Corbató, and Butler Lampson. Talk about building on the shoulder of giants. Definitely an experience in humility. So we've talked about interrupts. We talked about the history of interrupts. We've talked about interrupt coalescing and the parameters used for that. Well, how are virtual interrupts different? Well, as you know, real hardware I/O controllers are like little embedded systems with their own operating systems and things like timer support built into those controllers, and they execute independent of the main host processor. Unlike that, device emulation in virtualization executes on general purpose multi-user and time-shared architectures, in our case, the x86. So in these environments, we can't install high-resolution timers as a matter of course. Well, technically, we could, but the host would be overwhelmed by the resulting interrupt storm. This would result in other processes and VMs being severely impacted. Besides, solving the VM interrupt coalescing problem shouldn't be done by increasing the interrupt rate on the host. That just defeats the whole purpose. Okay, so let's promise ourselves to not install high-res timers to solve the VM interrupt coalescing problem. But then how would we solve it? Well, with some neat tricks. So let's get into it. The first intuition behind virtual interrupt coalescing is, let's pretend. How about we pretend that the hardware I/O completion themselves are our timers? It's kind of a weird little subtle concept. Since we can't just program these I/O completions to our desired rate, there's a whole bunch of other asynchronous reasons why they come when they come. But let's try to just see if we can pull it off anyway. And if we can do that, what we can do is we can piggyback our logic for whether or not to deliver an interrupt on these completion handlers, whereas hardware I/O controllers do it on their embedded hardware timers. Okay, because you need a place to run this code. So we decide to run it in context of the hardware I/O completions that the hypervisor, the host, will receive. Okay, so if we deliver in line with the hardware I/O completions, that starts to motivate a different style of thinking. For example, you can start to think about delivery as a problem where you try to come up with a delivery ratio. Okay. So for every N completions received from the hardware I/O controller, let's deliver, say, one interrupt, virtual interrupt. So let's carry on with this. This is really interesting. We felt this was going to take us somewhere. So talking further about this delivery ratio, a naive implementation would deliver an interrupt for one out of every N hardware completions. Okay, this is kind of equivalent to the typical MCC parameter that I just told you about, the max coalesce count parameter in hardware. But there's a problem with this. Notice that it limits the delivery ratio to be 1 over N. For example, 1 over 1 for delivering all completions as interrupts, or 1 over 2, 1 over 3, 1 over 4, so on and so forth. Notice you cannot express, say, a delivery ratio of 80% with this, because you're always 1 over something. And we have lots of experimental evidence that suggests that the jump from 100% interrupt delivery all the way down to 50 in one fell swoop actually leaves performance on the floor in terms of achieved throughput. So efficiency is lost because of that. So here's what we propose. Let's use two counting parameters, whereas MCC has one. We're going to count up to a certain value, and we're going to skip up to the next. This allows us to express arbitrary fractional delivery rates. So for example, to get 80% delivery rate, we deliver up to 4 and skip up to 5. So we deliver 80% of the interrupts. Okay. So that was the first intuition. Now, second intuition, which is this is really critical, is best illustrated by an example. Suppose you have two situations. You have an application on the right-hand side that has 32 commands in flight. And on the left-hand side, you have another application which has 4 commands in flight. You can think of this as like a pipeline, the depth of the pipeline. Suppose that a scheme coalesces two completions. Now notice on the right-hand side, with the pipeline depth of 32, coalescing two completions is not going to reduce that pipeline by much in terms of percentage. Whereas if you did that for the commands in flight case of 4, you're effectively halving the pipeline depth, and that's going to have consequences on your achieved throughput. So this motivates for us to think about tying together the two concepts that I've talked about so far, which is the delivery ratio in the last couple of slides, and this idea of commands in flight. And what we want to do is we want to come up with a function which makes the delivery ratio a function of commands in flight. Now, this commands in flight thing is pretty subtle, so let's go through this. I have an example here of a storage system where, focus on the bottom right, bottom left for you guys, which is throughput. That's left, right? Yeah, okay. So on the x-axis, I have commands in flight, and the y-axis is throughput. Notice that, like most systems that you're used to seeing, as you increase load, the throughput keeps going up, and after some point in time, the throughput gets saturated. You can't get any more throughput. Now, in this case, if you have a naive implementation of interrupt coalescing, what that's going to do is it's going to reduce your effective commands in flight because you're coalescing interrupts, which means the host isn't immediately able to issue more. So the effective commands in flight is going to go down. Look at what happens when you do that. If the commands in flight at the operating point was pretty low, then any reduction in the effective commands in flight is going to dramatically reduce throughput. Okay? And so you want to be very careful when your commands in flight are low. Here's another example. The operating point, bottom right, is pretty high already. And so a reduction in the effective commands in flight has a very negligible or no drop in throughput. And that's the intuition that we're going to build on. Okay, so we had this idea of delivery ratio as depending upon commands in flight. And the way we do it was actually we measure the dynamic commands in flight in a running system. And we dynamically and automatically vary the delivery ratio inversely with the commands in flight. So here's the exact parameters in our system. As the commands in flight go up, we can get down into the range where we're delivering 12 or 6% of completions as interrupts without having loss of performance because we're hugging the optimal curve very closely here. But there's some loose ends I want to get, I want to talk about. You recall that we're using hardware completions to fire virtual interrupts. Now you're probably wondering what the consequence of that are because it seems too easy, right? It seems too easy that you can get away without using timers. Well, here's a question that you might be wondering. What if the next hardware completion that we want to piggyback on never comes? That's a problem. Now that's a real problem in networking. Turns out in storage, there's always a future I/O that's going to arrive as long as your commands in flight is greater than zero. Because there's a command in flight and you know that it's going to complete. Now there are error cases. There are other situations where you can end up in problems, so we deal with that by short-circuiting to deliver for low commands in flight situations. So if you have one or two or three, depending upon the parameters in the system that you can set dynamically, you know, we will actually just not coalesce at that point in time. So we deal with that situation. Another question you might have is, well, what if the hardware completions are too far apart? Recall that the reason why the hardware controllers are using interrupts in the first place is to keep that latency bounded. Well, we have the same problem here, but here we don't control that latency. And so what we do to deal with that, and the details of this are very interesting, but I won't have time to cover them here, but effectively what we're doing is we're actually measuring that average latency. And when it drops below a certain threshold such that the intercompletion latency might get too high, we actually dynamically enable or disable virtual interrupt coalescing. So we exactly deal with that situation. Okay. Now, another question a lot of people have is trickle I/O. A classic example of that is DD in Linux. I haven't kept up with latest implementations, but certainly the last time I checked, DD was issuing one outstanding I/O at a time. You issue one I/O, when it completes, it comes back and you issue the next one. Now try doing interrupt coalescing in that kind of a situation, you're really gonna hurt performance. And in fact, there are, if you don't implement it correctly, you could end up with deadlock. So for trickle I/O situations, again, details in the paper, but we also measure and automatically enable it and disable virtual interrupt coalescing to be able to deal with that. Okay, so I've started off by saying that we're implementing this in a software platform running on a commodity processor, so there's some interesting things that you have to deal with. And so in our implementation of this, we took great care to minimize the cost of virtual interrupt coalescing and to make our design as portable as possible. For instance, our implementation and our design is very portable to other hypervisors on pretty much any CPU architecture. Our technique can also be implemented in firmware or hardware of I/O controllers. We do not use any floating point. We do not even use integer divisions. We do not use read TSEs in our critical path to keep the implementation very efficient. In our 64-bit virtual machine monitor, VMware's monitor, we measured the increase in the code and data segments, and they're very small, 400 bytes for the text segment. The actual lines of code is interesting also. For the LSI logic emulation in the monitor, the new lines of code introduced was less than 120. So the implementation, we worked really hard to get. It's very nice and tight. Let's look at some results. The paper contains a lot of details about micro benchmarks as well as application benchmarks. I'll mention a couple here. The GS Blaster and SQL ISM are application benchmarks, so a real application is actually running against a model workload. And we saw throughput improvements up to 19%. We also saw CPU efficiency improvements up to 17%. And so this gives us an idea that if these workloads, for example, were doing a lot of complicated calculation, that extra 17% of CPU efficiency would have actually gotten us, would have gotten those workloads a lot of benefit. Okay, but those are application benchmarks. Let's look at a real complicated workload. And in our case, what we did was we picked TBCC. And the transaction rate for that, we notice, increased up to 5% depending upon how you picked our parameters. The default parameters were more than 3% improvement. So let's look at TPCC in more detail. This is our internal TPCC testbed. I want to state the disclaimer right now in case TPCC calls us up and asks for an audit. This is a non-comparable implementation of TPCC, and the results are not TPCC compliant, and there are several deviations from the standard here. But nevertheless, this is our internal testbed, which we use extensively to, and is very, very close to what real TPCC would look like. So here we see a throughput increase, as I mentioned, 3 to 5%. We also see more users, and what the workload is trying to do is you keep adding users until you can't add any more, and this basically what it does is any optimization that you study, it results in some CPU efficiency improvement, which means you can fit more users. The actual storage IOPS also increases by a little bit. Notice that the interrupts per second delivered to this virtual machine decreases dramatically. And there's a proportional latency increase. We studied this in a bit of detail. And if you look at the increase in the number of users, throughput, and the transaction rate, the proportional latency increase, the latency increase is proportional to that. If folks have questions about it, I have lots of details that I can handle in the question and answer period. Now, so this is kind of high-level overall results. But I mentioned that our algorithm is doing all kinds of online adaptation. Remember I talked about how it can turn itself on and off and dynamically adjust the delivery ratio based on the actual measured commands in flight. Well, let's take a look at that dynamic adaptation. I love this plot. it demonstrates a couple of things. First of all, it demonstrates that TPCC is a highly variable workload. On the x-axis, we have seconds. So this is a very short period of time. We're not looking at hours here. And on the y-axis is the delivery ratio as determined by our algorithm. You'll notice at the top that there are some periods of time where the algorithm chooses not to do any interrupt coalescing, so it basically turns itself off. But if you look all the way down, you'll see that we have times when we're sitting less than 10% of completions delivered as interrupts. And all of this, and we still get a 5% improvement in the overall result for TPCC, as well as a improvement in overall throughput. So what this is really demonstrating is that all the cycles that we're freeing up, where the virtual machines were sitting processing interrupts, not doing useful work, is now being converted into useful work. So that's the key result here. Now, another plot here is if we take the previous data and make a histogram out of it, you can kind of see some interesting patterns. Most of the time, interrupt coalescing is enabled, and most of the time, you're sitting anywhere between one half and one quarter as the delivery ratio. Okay, so our implementation of interrupt coalescing, as described in our paper, has been the default for VMware's LSI logic virtual adapter in the ESX hypervisor since version 4.0. This was released in the second quarter of 2009. So we now have significant experience with deployments into the tens of thousands of virtual machines. Since then, we've not received any performance bug reports on the virtual interrupt coalescing algorithm. On the other hand, out of interest, I wanted to mention that we have another virtual adapter called the Paravirtual SCSI adapter, which was also shipped in the same release but did not initially have some of the optimizations that we developed and talk about in this paper. In particular, although it had the variable interrupt coalescing ratios depending upon commands in flight, very similar to the LSI logic patent, it was missing the automatic enable-disable based on the dynamic throughput that I had talked about. And also, it was not capable of setting the coalescing rate between one half and one. So as a result, several performance bugs were reported from the field. We triaged those to be related to those missing optimizations, which are now fixed in the subsequent ESX 4.1 release. We feel that this experience further validates the completeness of our approach. Okay, so some key takeaways. This is my last slide. What we looked at today was a revisiting of a 60-year-old problem. And we got some encouraging results. We were able to improve a benchmark like TPCC. Our experience with TPCC has been that we spent months getting a fractional percent of improvement in TPCC. And to be able to have an optimization that gets you 3 to 5% in one fell swoop was actually very exhilarating. Other benchmarks also improve. Takeaway, I think, is I encourage you to do is to take another look at your interrupt subsystem. You might be surprised to find all sorts of interesting optimization opportunities, whether by interrupt coalescing using the techniques that we've described or other ones. I did not talk about IPI coalescing, but we found that also to be very beneficial, and some of the details are in the paper. And the interesting thing for IPI coalescing is that that is one of those techniques that actually hasn't been done well, and I've noticed several operating systems not doing nice IPI coalescing. So opportunities exist for that, definitely. Even in the virtual interrupt coalescing scheme that we've talked about, there are more optimization opportunities. For example, automatically setting the parameters, the ones that we have set manually right now, is interesting. Using device modeling, for example, to figure out exactly what the ratios, delivery ratios to commands and flight relationship is a very interesting area. We can get into places where you can hug the optimal curve almost exactly if we go down those opportunities. So I'd encourage the community to take a look at that. I've kind of, since 2009, and my team has moved on from this problem. So this is an open area, please feel free to get in there. Finally, I'd like to motivate thinking along these lines to, change the rules when they weigh you down, which is what this work has tried to do. For storage I/O, even though, the work in this area is 30, 40 years old. But the question is there something that can be done for networking where we can change the rules for networking interrupt coalescing? For example, is there an equivalent of commands in flight out there for networking? What about TCP window size? Does that get you anything? I don't know. I have not tried it. There's obviously complications there. It's very hard. But I wanted to use that as an example to motivate further research in this area. Thank you, and I'd love to take your questions.
Roger Rangaswamy, Florida International University.
Hi, Roger.
Really enjoyed the talk. And I had a question. Can you run into some corner case where you really need a timer? Yesterday at the hot storage panel, we had this 5-second SSD delay.
Yeah.
And that usually happens when you have a whole bunch of write commands in flight. And I mean, or is that something that you have a different way of dealing with that?
Okay, it's a great question. So in a hypervisor, there are timer interrupts that fire. So automatically, as part of the normal course of things, there are opportunities for you to inspect the state of whether or not interrupts have been delivered. So this is the usual, 10 hertz kind of, or 100 hertz, or 1,000 hertz, depending upon exactly where you're running type of timers. So those opportunities exist. So there's kind of a max bounded latency there. The other interesting thing is that there are other optimizations here. The way that the architecture is, and the details of that are in the paper, the way the architecture is allows us to have, for example, whenever there's an exit from the virtual machine into the monitor, and this happens because of some privileged instruction or some other types of I/O type activity, we have the opportunity to inspect the completion queue. Okay, so all those things add up to, fairly tight bounds on maximum latency. But I agree that we should study that more. But I think so far from our results that we've seen, it's pretty well bounded.
Okay, I have one more question.
Yeah.
Because you're changing the time at which interrupts get delivered,
yes.
Do you have to worry about the OS not knowing about the fact that you're dealing interrupts and doing something that it shouldn't be doing?
Do you have an example in mind of that? It seems like an
interesting... some kind of timeout inside the OS for a device that doesn't respond.
Okay. So what we found is that there are cases where if an I/O device does not return in reasonable time, that some operating systems, especially older ones, so you're looking at kind of NT and prior and some variants of Linux, they do go into very pathological behavior. And so we have tons of investment in kind of understanding, reverse engineering, figuring out what cases lead to those problems, and then dealing with them and responding. So, for example, if you hear nothing from a storage device, there are problems. However, if you get if you get some signals back, you can deal with some of the problems. So things like aborts and so forth that can keep the virtual machine kind of in a keep alive mode for longer periods of time. all of those problems that we've seen are in the multiple seconds range. Okay, and the way we've implemented virtual interrupt coalescing is that there's no way you can have that an interrupt sitting in our queues for that long, because you would have seen a halt at which time we would have checked. You would have seen an exit at which time we would have checked. You would have seen a host timer at the 100 hertz, for example, at which time we would have delivered.
Great, thanks.
You're welcome.
I have a couple of questions
yes.
as well. So my first question is, have you studied the effect of this technique on performance variability of certain workloads? I mean, some workloads such as search, when the response time is highly variable, that's not a good thing. And so I was wondering if this has any effect on that.
Yeah, so if I was to understand the question, so basically there's some inherent variability in I/O completion times, okay? And the question is, as far as I understand, that is this increasing that variability? Is it?
And not necessarily in I/O completion times, but in end-to-end performance of the workload. Does it increase variability?
Okay, so I have not done end-to-end measurements of performance variability from the application level from this, but I have looked at variability from the point of view of just the I/O completion, because that's the only path that we're affecting. So what we've seen is that the overall characteristic of variability doesn't change very much, so in terms of the aggregates, but it becomes more structured. Okay, but just like most interrupt coalescing types of algorithms, it becomes, you know, instead of a lot of noise, you get bands. So it does change. The characteristic of the variability does change.
Interesting. So it could actually improve, it could actually reduce end-to-end variability if you have, you know, less noise.
I mean, you know, the classic way, an easy way of improving variability is to take the really fast returning I/O and slow it down. And it's like taking my distribution and compressing it artificially, and then now you can claim that you've reduced variability. And so some of that is happening, and it happens with hardware I/O coalescing as well. But that's an interesting way to look at it.
Is it time? All right. Try to give a quick question. I like this work. The results are a little bit in conflict with my understanding of how long interrupt takes. My understanding with the current machines interrupt probably take less than a microsecond. Your results, in particular TPCC results, suggest that by reducing, I think, 3,000 interrupts per second, you get 3 to 5% improvement. That suggests the interrupt cost at the level of about 10 microseconds. That seems to be high from my understanding.
Yeah, so there's a couple of effects going on. One is that you're dealing with multiple layers, and virtualization is adding definitely lots of layers. Any interrupt that you cause to a virtual machine results in that virtual machine exiting into the monitor, doing a lot of processing, polluting caches, and so on and so forth, and going back up. Now, if you look at the throughput result for TPCC, you notice that that is only increasing by a little bit, whereas the result for TPCC overall benchmark is improving by up to 5%. And the reason for that is that there's a lot of interleaving of I/O and CPU activity. Now, TPCC is well known to be very level 2 cache sensitive. And so any pollution that you do in the cache causes problems. So just by having fewer exits or fewer interrupts, it has kind of almost a nonlinear improvement here, because the effect itself is an L2 cache pollution effect.
All right, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.